the president has not done enough for his quote-unquote black constituency. That is a misperception. I submit to you the Millionaire Reserve Initiative, the Illinois Department of Natural Resources, the white people are eating, they're paying their mortgages off the salaries that they're earning in these bureaucracies.
Go ahead.
Where we have never even accessed the ability to use our own tax dollars to empower our community.
Yeah.
So I'm not here to lecture. I'm here to go through the session to speak to you as a community organizer, who has made a commitment to building institution long term. And I have another brother in the room who is my age. I turned 70, survived triple bypass heart surgery last year. Lord has given me 20 more minutes, and you be sure that I'm going to be holding up when we talk about the second point on it was key people from Brownsville. For me, the three most important people were the three people who put together the restricted covenant ballot out of the Supreme Life Insurance Company fought against the University of Chicago, who had restricted us based on real estate. Those were Truman K. Gibson, who was the chairman of our board, chairman emeritus of our board, Truman K. Gibson Jr., Irving Mollison and Earl B. Dickerson, who were the three attorneys who went into the restricted covenant case in 1938, took up 10 years all the way to the Supreme Court to break that restricted covenant. Thereby, the area that we claim as Brownsville is not some nebulous loosey-goosey, you know, where do you think it's at? We know exactly where it's at. Block by block, house by house. That is your actual map, and on it you will see prior to 1948, we didn't live in Park Manor, we didn't live in Chatham, we didn't live in none of those communities further south. We lived along Lake Street. We lived in next to, this is Englewood, that little square you see just to the west of us, but you see on the northern boundary, coming 18th Street, all the way to the tip of 71st and Cottage Grove. We have annexed into it the Oakwood Cemetery because of the history of who's buried there, and also the Civil War military history, which is exhibited right here at the monument to Stephen A. Douglas, who debated the Lincoln-Douglas debates. So the whole Civil War issue is an issue of bringing 6,000 prisoners from the South and storing them up here in a prison camp, right? Mm-hmm. That launched the railroad industry, which launched the whole meatpacking industry with Armour Square and all the meatpackers. All of that history came out of the migration of us breaking slavery, coming out of antebellum South, Jim Crow, and coming to the North seeking what? The promised land. And Dr. King said, I might not get there with you, but we as a people will get to the promised land. I submit to you, we're on it. You need to drop your buckets where you are, figure out how you can save the structures, how we create adaptive reuse strategies. What we're talking about is multiple sites and attractions within a destination. So in the case of Maywood, or in the case of Robbins, we're talking about how do you leverage your opportunity with the museum as an anchor development, and what can spin off of that in terms of having a selection of activities that a traveler can come through there and experience the authentic culture of the Roberts community. That's the work that you're doing in Maywood.
Yes.
All hats off to Fred and Malcolm. Those are my two number one heroes. I didn't say Martin. Fred and Malcolm. In terms of, again, I'm proletarian. I'm born 662 East 38th Place, on welfare, the whole nine yards. If we don't break the cycle of poverty, we're going to pass it on to the next generation. And if you look, we had kids out here in front of the library the other day with 2x4s trying to bust each other in the head. And didn't stop when the police came. So there is a serious loss of connection to the understanding of the protracted struggle that we're involved in for our emancipation. It didn't end when Lincoln freed the slaves. It ain't gonna end tomorrow. But if we don't keep our love of our collective cultural history, support our young people, link them to their histories, show them where the growth industries are, and literally assist them to get into those industries, they're going to be victimized by the criminal justice system, the prison industrial complex, early childhood sexuality, etc. You're seeing it in the 12 and 13 year olds.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the fallout of a cup, and if you ain't read this, you need to get a copy of the read what this current man's doing.
The name of the magazine?
This is Reader. The Reader magazine comes out once a week. This is the current issue, And quietly we're doing the NATO, but behind the scenes, it's game, y'all. Right. They're putting their deals together. And they support the same 1%ers who are controlling the real estate, et cetera, and they really don't respect the authentic cultural experience in the black community.
They just don't.
So I could pull up DCEO and show you the last 10 years of appropriations for tourism. We're not in that page nowhere, right? The black community's not in that page nowhere. Yet this North Avenue Chamber of Commerce is being funded with your tax dollars, as are all the convention and tourism bureaus throughout the state of Illinois, McCormick Place, 5 o'clock when the door let out, who you see going out to build? All white folks living off your tax dollars under a black president. So this is very serious business in terms of how do we build capacity in the growth industry. First of all,